Next up on This Week in Law, Irina Manta, Mike Risch, Sarah Pearson, and I discuss uploading our souls to Google, the NSA's powers, the first rule of FISA Club, naughty net bad guys, and much more next on This Week in Law.
Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is TWiT.
Bandwidth for This Week in Law is provided by CashFly at CACHEFLY.com.
This is TWiL, This Week in Law with Denise Howell and Sarah Pearson. Episode 306, recorded June 5th, 2015. Leave the Batlith with the Bailiff. This episode of This Week in Law is brought to you by FreshBooks, the super simple cloud accounting and invoicing solution that can help your law firm and any small business save time billing and get paid faster. Try it free at freshbooks.com/twill. Hi, folks. I'm Denise Howell. You're joining us for This Week in Law, and I'm so excited that you are joining us. There's been so much going on the legal and privacy front. On the consumer privacy front in the last week or so, there's tons to talk about. And we've got a great panel to do it. This week, I'd like you to welcome along with me, Irina Manta, to the show. She's the director of the Intellectual Property Law Clinic at Hofstra University School of Law, where she also teaches IP and other forms of technology-related law. Hello, Irina.
Hi, how are you, Denise?
I'm great. It's wonderful to have you with us.
Thanks for having me.
Also joining us from Villanova University School of Law is Michael Risch. Hello, Michael.
Hi, how are you doing?
Mike also teaches on the IP front. What are your other specialties that you emphasize in your study and teaching?
I work primarily in patent law and copyright and trade secret, but also in internet law.
Perfect. Wonderful to have you on the show too.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
And back again after her break last week is Sarah Pearson from Creative Commons. Hello, Sarah.
Hey, Denise. I'm glad to be back. I always feel kind of out of the loop when I miss a week. So
I know we missed you a lot, but we had a fun show. I encourage you to go back and catch up on it. But it's great to have you with us.
Thanks.
All right. So I scarcely was able to tear myself away and do the show today because of Google Photos, because it is such a gripping product, as various reviewers have been commenting. There are also a great many privacy ramifications about uploading your heart and soul, which is basically what your photo library is, to Google. So let's start out talking about that. I've just sort of dipped my toe in the water of Google Photos. I had a laptop that I wanted to migrate some old photos off that weren't really part of my centralized photo library that lives on another machine. So I put those up there first just to see what it was like. And it's like nothing else. It's really quite amazing and wonderful. And where has Google been hiding this tool? Apparently they've been hiding it connected to Google Plus, where it has, I've been involved in Google Plus since that product's inception. And the photo products there have always been interesting, but I think decoupling it and making it very mobile friendly to work hand in hand with your mobile device and your desktop device and, you know, become the Gmail for your photos, which is the tagline that a lot of people have been calling the product. It was really a wise move on Google's part. And even with people who have trepidations about their privacy and giving all of this very, very personal and very close to home in every way conceivable information to Google, are finding that they want to do it anyway. And I, I understand that conclusion. And I think that I ultimately will wind up putting all my photos there. And the reason that I think I'm comfortable doing that is I've been a Gmail user for many, many years. We were talking last week about Nicole Wong making her children read privacy policies before they use products. And I think that in this particular case, it's a really good idea. particularly if you use other Google products, to go through and read Google's privacy policy, which I've done in preparation for the show. I don't know if our panelists have had the time or maybe had their children do it for them, but we can talk about the particulars of the privacy policy a bit and take everyone's temperature on what's going on here and how comfortable they are with this and other Google products. Sarah, have you taken a look at it yet?
I had my toddler read the privacy policy for me.
There we go.
I did at least skim to the privacy policy. And I think I haven't checked out Google Photos yet, but I am probably likely to make the same decision as you because I'm a big Gmail user and Google Docs user as well. And I think it's so interesting to think about how, on an individual level, it might not even be necessarily rational to not use something that's so convenient because of the privacy issues. But it's the, on the collective level when these privacy issues really become more, problematic. So to me, it makes perfect sense that people might weigh the cost benefits and decide to use it anyway, but it doesn't mean, I don't think that, even though I may be one of those people, I don't think that necessarily means that the fact that they're collecting all of this data is a good thing. So it's kind of an interesting, I realize that that's somewhat hypocritical, but.
Yeah, well, I mean, I think everybody finds themselves in that boat where, you feel a little, is this really a good idea? But the product is so compelling and so needed, I think, that to have, a central, searchable, usable place where all your devices access, get in and out of, deposit the photos they take and can access the photos you've taken in the past. It's definitely been a need that needed to be filled, and Google's done a great job of jumping into that void. Let me tell you a couple of particulars from Google's privacy policy, or maybe we should back up and start with a bit of the history of Google's privacy policies, which used to be separate for each product. It was about a year ago that Google decided it is our goal as a company to unify your user experience and to have our products talk to each other and share data with each other. So why not unify the privacy policy, which they did about a year ago. They just updated again as of May 1st and also created something called Google Account, which is, I don't know if that replaces, I know they had a privacy dashboard or maybe it integrates that now into Google Account, but there are ways there to go through and do a privacy checkup and check in, be very well versed with how Google is using your information. There are ways to tweak how Google uses your information, whether you want ads to be as relevant as possible by looking at information that Google can glean from your account or not, et cetera. So it's well worth going through there and checking how comfortable you are with the permissions you're giving Google. And one thing that really stood out for me, aside from the simplicity of the privacy policy, it's pretty lengthy, but it's also very clearly written. Granted, I'm a lawyer and I've read a lot of and written a lot of privacy policies, so I might have an easier time getting through this than the average layperson. But as privacy policies go, I can say this one is pretty clear and concise. And I really love that it assures people that you're not going to have your rights reduced under this privacy policy without notice. And it's going to have to be good notice. Actually noticeable notice from Google. I do think that that is an important bit to put in, even though that's already legally required. Companies can't change their policies in a material way without giving you notice that is significant and reasonable. But to actually put that in the policy and remind people that that's what's going on here, I think is a good thing. Irina, have you looked at both the new Google Photos product? And I know that consumer privacy is something that your studies and teaching specifically focus on, correct?
Yes, I looked at the policy indeed, and I've not used the product yet. I am a longtime Gmail user. I agree with you. I found the policy to be remarkably clear, very well interlinked. So anybody who's interested in privacy, hopefully even people that are not law types like ourselves, are able to navigate it and really understand what's going on. And you know, there's a certain sense in some of the articles that have been out there recently of people saying, oh, I kind of want to use the product, but I kind of don't want to give them that information. There's a little bit of a sense of wanting to have your cake and eating it too, right? Nobody's forcing you to use Google Photos. You know, your life is not going to end if it's not a product you end up using. And so I think people will end up using it at different kinds of levels. So some won't use it at all. Some will use it very selectively. For instance, they'll say, I'm not putting pictures of my children on there. And some will use it very freely. And I think that's the same thing that we're seeing with Facebook and with other products in social media and elsewhere. And as long as the policy is clearly laid out, and I think this one is, that seems fair to me.
One thing I have not checked out specifically, and it's not really specifically dealt with. I read both the privacy policy that now applies to all of Google's products and the user guidelines that apply to photos and a few other products. And what I have not seen mentioned is Google Takeout, which is its how you suck your data back out of Google product. That doesn't mean, I think, that your data necessarily gets permanently deleted from Google, but it's portable. You know, if you want your data out of there in it to be able to be used in another place, it lets you do that. I would like to see Google give us some guidance as to whether you're able to permanently delete photos. It appears, I think, that you are. Because you get a warning when you go to delete something that's been put in Google Photos that it's going to be deleted, you know, on an item by item basis from Google Photos and also from any synced devices. So it would be nice if there were a batch function that could provide users with that level of comfort as well, and maybe worked hand in hand with Google Takeout. What do you think, Mike?
I wouldn't hold your breath to see such flexibility. Mm-hmm. The privacy policy is pretty clear that they get to sell whatever information they get from you to anybody they want. So I think you could take your photos out, but whatever information they've gleaned in order to build your profile, once they have that and have sold it, I think you're not getting it back. I think it's just done. And maybe that's just pessimistic or cynical of me, but I think the reason we don't see them saying we'll delete stuff when you ask is because they won't delete stuff when you ask. So I think that's that. I agree with you all that the privacy policy is pretty well written and transparent. It's also very broad, though. I mean, they can use the information for lots of stuff, but we've always known that's pretty true.
I'm looking now on their new My Account page that we were talking about a moment ago, this central dashboard, and I'm looking at the Delete Your Account or Services section, and there's nothing that specifically refers to photos yet, so maybe that's by design. Maybe they haven't caught up with that. When you go to Delete Google Account and Data, oh goodness, I better... don't want to delete my Google account, but there is a link. When you go here, you can download your data before deleting your account. Here we go. Photos. It's in there. All this content will be deleted. Your data, let's see. The list below may not contain every Google service affected by your deletion, such as services Google no longer supports. Your data will be deleted from these services as well. So right now I have close to 3,000 photos in there, and it's telling me if I go ahead and proceed, it's going to delete all of them. So it does appear that, you know, you have to, it's a few clicks deep, but if you're anxious to get your data out of there, it seems like they're giving you the ability to do it. What does this mean, Irina? from the bigger picture, not just related to this one product, but to how Google's going to synchronize, you know, the thousands of people that are photos that people are already in the process of uploading to this service with the rest of their data.
Well, certainly there is, depending on consumers' choice, depending on whether they make that data available to Google or not, there are going to be more relationships and types of data that Google will be able to analyze between the different kinds of data that it gets from consumers. And now photos will become another element of that. So what some of the press has mentioned is things like, what kinds of brands are people wearing in their photos, right? What kinds of activities are they pursuing? How will that help us with marketing? And so certainly that type of data will be of interest ultimately to advertisers. And this is part of a larger picture of, you know, of this type of data about people being shared more broadly anyway, including across devices, including as part of the entire conversation about the Internet of Things. And certainly it will require a higher level of awareness on the part of people if they want to opt out of as much of this stuff as possible. So once you're getting started and you see the convenience of Google Photos, it's going to be harder to kind of pull back out of that, especially if you become part of a community of users that are all sharing those kinds of interests.
Yeah, the part of why this is such a compelling product is they're really giving you a lot in exchange for the data that you're giving them. They're giving you a way to meaningfully search your photos by either keyword or their facial recognition. There have been a lot of posts about how it's gotten it wrong, but it's surprising how much it gets it right. So you can search by person, you can search by theme, you can search by color, you can search by location, you can search by show me everything with sky or beach or anything, you know, you can imagine that's in your photos. I've come up empty a bunch of times during doing searches. So some things that are too specific don't seem to work that well, but this is a nice way to sort through and find things. And I think a lot of people are having a really visceral, emotional response to having their photos accessible this way and, you know, surfacing things they haven't seen in a really long time. If you want an example of what I'm talking about, there's a great piece at The Verge called Laughing and Crying My Way Through Google Photos by Ryan Gantz that is very indicative of how this is affecting people. But getting back to the product itself and how it might be affecting Google's strategies, Sarah, getting into the facial recognition, one thing that I found myself doing since uploading a few thousand photos to the product is photos that I've taken of friends and their families that I may not have shared with them back at that time because it was pre-social media. Immediately, you know, my first impulse is, you know, oh, my friend's son is turning 19 today. This was yesterday. And here I just found a bunch of pictures when he was about 5, when we all went to Disneyland. So I shipped those off immediately to them. One thing that occurred to me is that perhaps down the road, Google will have the notion that, you know, if you are sufficiently friendly with someone, I wouldn't have to instigate that. My friend could come and see what photos I had taken of her son that she already didn't have in her possession. What do you think about that kind of plan?
Yeah, I can imagine for sure that there'll be, and then that also raises lots of tricky issues, right? Because as Google starts to recognize more and more people in your photos, and maybe they don't have the same privacy, you know, thoughts that you do, or they're perhaps more concerned about it. You can imagine there will be lots of those types of issues are kind of already faced, I guess, on Facebook and a lot of social media because, you know, you can tag people and you can adjust those settings. So I imagine they're just going to have to be thinking about more and more layers of settings and where they draw the line and those kinds of questions. One thing I wanted to touch on that Irina was just talking about was this question of choice and how you have, you know, consumers ultimately have the choice to use or not use the products, which is of course true. I think though, as especially with something as, you know, behemoth as Google that controls so much of what we do online, at a certain point, it seems a bit disingenuous to consider it a choice. Just because, you know, I mean, I suppose you have the choice to not use the internet too, but you would be, you know, severely handicapping yourself in terms of your professional life in particular and also your personal life. So to the extent they're more and more ubiquitous, this idea of, you know, personal choice, I think is harder to fall back on. And I don't think that it changes the fact that, you know, Google and all these private companies have a responsibility, but also that policymakers and all of us have a responsibility to think about these issues from a more collective level as opposed to just the individual. Because I think that's mm-hmm. where they really, you know, that's where the impact really happens. So,
well, I think the market pressure on Apple is a great thing. Apple wants to be that choice, right? And Tim Cook was just honored by the Electronic Privacy Information Center, EPIC. It's first time EPIC has ever honored a business person for their stance on consumer privacy, but he was honored for corporate leadership during EPIC's Champions of Freedom event in Washington. A quote from him there is, "We at Apple reject the idea that our customers should have to make trade-offs between privacy and security. We can and we must provide both in equal measure. We believe that people have a fundamental right to privacy. The American people demand it, the Constitution demands it, and morality demands it." So, you know, much as I want to love Apple and love those sentiments and, you know, want to, if it worked as well, keep my photo universe, in Apple's hands where it has resided for, you know, the better part of the last decade. I've tried out iCloud. I've tried, you know, syncing, the same sort of syncing that Google is doing here from device and from desktop to one central location made possible by Apple, and the experience has not been anywhere near as pleasant or the same. So, you know, I think it's good that Apple's being pushed to better those products and better the user experience, and perhaps in the long run, its stance on privacy, once it does so, we'll win the day. But I don't know where that's going to go. What do you think, Mike?
Well, I think that what we're going to see are choices. If people say we believe in privacy, you're going to have choices between people who offer this and make you pay for it, people who offer it and say it's free, scare quotes, but the free is basically we get to harvest all your information. And it's not like this technology is unheard of. I mean, Facebook has had photos where you can tag and you can search for people in photos before. And so, but not with the repository that Google has. So what Google's basically done is taken the Facebook tagging, storing, image recognition, and then scaled it up to a repository, which is fantastic. But somebody's got to pay for that. And I guess it's going to be the advertisers. And if Apple says, well, we value your privacy, then it's going to have to be the users. And the users maybe don't want to pay for that, and therefore they're not building it. So it may be we'll see competition if people say, yeah, you know what, we value our privacy enough to shell out the extra dollars. So far, I don't think consumers have said that. So far, consumers have said, we want it for free, we don't want to pay. And as a result, privacy is the cost.
Right. Yeah, assuming that continues, Irina, I'm wondering if you could try and gaze into your crystal ball a little bit for us. You were talking a bit already about ways that people speculate how having an enormous database of people's photos could be monetized. How could it be monetized in a good, warm and fuzzy kind of way that people are going to enjoy and wonder how they lived without? And how could it be monetized in a really creepy way on the other end of the spectrum?
I think some of this has to do with our cultural sensitivities about targeted advertising. So one thing that I noticed in Google's privacy policy is that one way they're trying to strike a balance is by saying we're not going to use data that has to do with things like race or religion or sexual orientation. And so I think that's how they're trying to say, okay, there are certain kinds of data that we're going to treat differently because we know that that's something that many individuals will be sensitive to having used. So as this evolves, as people become more used to having targeted advertising around, they're going to find certain things less creepy than maybe they would have otherwise. And some of this interacts interestingly with this question of consent. So, for instance, when Facebook used people's pictures in advertising in a way that was not consented to, they ended up having to shell out millions of dollars as a result of a lawsuit because they weren't supposed to do that. So these policies really do have to be crystal clear and spelled out. But then there is also a level where the media has a responsibility, and you're part of the media that's fulfilling that responsibility, to educate people and to tell them, here are the ways in which that data is being used. Oh, you're wondering how you got this kind of advertising, or perhaps even down the line, some kind of phone call as a result of this. Here's how that works out, right? But I do think I'm having a fundamental disagreement here with Sarah in terms of how this kind of data should be regulated. What I don't want to see is that the most successful companies become victims of their own success and become punished accordingly by having the government say, all right, well, now that everybody uses dot, 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 right, whether it's Google as a search engine or something else, now we get to control you. And now we get to dictate your policies. And now we get to tell you what kind of privacy you should have. I think Michael is exactly right that you're going to have companies that will give you more privacy and companies that will give you less privacy. And you'll pay different prices and you'll have different levels of convenience, as you pointed out, Denise, because mm-hmm. you're not going to be able to search things a certain way. So there are two things, though, that I think we need to be aware here, which is things that you didn't consent to that the company didn't cause. And one of those things comes from the government and having the government get its hands on that kind of data. And that's something where I'm hoping we will see more protections rather than fewer, because it's often things that the companies themselves don't want. And then it's also a matter of protecting against hackers, because that's the other major unconsented to use. And that is very creepy to people. In part, it's creepy because it can have real financial consequences for them if their data is stolen and used in all kinds of ways that might take months or years to repair.
One thing we should mention, and you touched on it, Irina, is the notion that, say, there's a photo of you holding a Diet Coke that Google has come into possession of as you've gleefully uploaded your entire library. I think people are worried that that could, as Irina was mentioning, show up as an ad for the Coca-Cola company or some sort of implied endorsement, you know, that because you had a Coke once, you think everybody else should buy Coke. And that's specifically dealt with in the privacy policy, that there won't be any commercial use of photographs in that way for any promotional purposes without the express and explicit separate permission, not just the whatever permission you might be granting by using the product of the individual in question. So I don't think that's part of their business model. They're not working to build on that. I don't, you know, really see a flurry of letters going out to people. Hey, we saw that you were holding a Coke. Coke would like to use that photo. Although I could be wrong, you know, maybe that could be a really lucrative way to put advertisers together with enthusiastic consumers who want to be featured in ads. Who knows? But it seems like that would be secondary to the business model that Google has in mind for this product. And the other thing that I just wanted to highlight is there's another good piece at TechCrunch on the service. This one is by Natasha Lomas. The headline is Google Photos Reminder Smile. It's free. You're the product. And they got some additional comments from Google in the course of doing the story, which the author calls pieces of colorless window dressing, but here they are. Your Google Photos account is just as private and secure as any other Google service. We don't share your information with others unless you explicitly choose to share it with them. And Google Photos will not use images or videos uploaded, and this is what I was talking about a second ago, onto Google Photos commercially for any promotional purposes unless we ask for the user's explicit permission. One thing that talking through that made me remember to bring up is the fact that one of the ways that you can share photos that you've uploaded is to get a shareable link, a web link. So what will happen as those get shared around is, you know, a whole lot of photos that are available if you just know the link. And granted, the links are long and complicated and hashed, and I'm sure designed to be not guessable. But Mike, does that give you any pause?
It does. In fact, my own cloud service has those links, and it worries me when I share those. So if you hack, I guess if it's long enough, it would take a long time to hack those. But a company the size of Google, you're going to have lots of links, and you're going to hit on some random ones. So anytime you've got a non-protected photo protected only by brute force, you are asking for trouble.
Right. Sarah, I think you were going to jump in with something before we went down another tangent. Do you remember what it was?
I'm not sure what I was going to say, but I did want to respond to what Irina said, which I think you're completely right, Irina, that the answer is not for, you know, government to control our data by any means. I guess I'm just trying to make the point that I think the market is not a perfect solution to protecting privacy just because individuals don't feel the privacy harms as much as we might feel it on a more, you know, societal level. I don't know what the answer is to that problem, but I think defaulting to, you know, the market will work it out, to me just doesn't work. But I think you're right that I certainly don't believe that the government should be the one to control our data.
They would love it if we'd voluntarily upload everything too, right?
Right.
Irina, you did a great article on a product that we, you know, it's jibes very well with what we're discussing here and we've discussed before on the show, Hello Barbie. Your piece is called Hello Barbie. They will monitor you, then they will discriminate against you perfectly. Could you expand on that idea for us?
Sure. So this is a piece that I wrote with my co-author, David Olson, and that's coming out in the Alabama Law Review this fall. So the general idea behind this piece was that, you know, people are concerned about the issues that we're discussing right now, which are that companies are increasingly getting their hands on data and are able to engage in various forms of monitoring through that data. And what we're arguing is that through that monitoring, companies will be able to engage in a greater level of price discrimination, meaning that they will offer certain kinds of products with certain capabilities at different price points, depending on what level of capabilities you get. You can compare that with, you know, getting a ticket in business class on a plane instead of getting a ticket in economy. And because you have the person paying a higher price in business class, you have cross-subsidization, and the person that gets the ticket in economy gets to pay a lower price. So there is often a negative reaction when people first hear about price discrimination or they feel that they are the victims of price discrimination. But we're arguing that it will make products available to people at lower prices, including to people who might not be able to afford the products at all otherwise, right? So there might be some limitations that come with them, just like when you buy a Microsoft Office student version and you get a specific license for that, you're not going to have the full capability that the business package offers, but you might not have been able to get it at that lower price point at all, but for Microsoft's ability to engage in that type of discrimination. And so, you know, we're tying all of that to the Internet of Things and the data that will be gathered that way and how that will facilitate a company's ability to do that. So our conclusion is that we should allow companies to engage in restrictive software licensing practices, and we believe that the market will moderate the ability of companies to do so in a way that consumers dislike or can't tolerate.
Okay. One thing that I think is really interesting along what the lines of what we've been discussing is that privacy lawsuits seem to be down. Joe Mullen has a piece this week at Ars Technica showing that there used to be a lot more privacy suits being filed in 2010, 2011 saw a little dip, 2012 was higher than ever. And then in the last several years, obviously 2015 is still in progress, but 2013 and 2014 were way down. And so Joe spends some time musing on that, why the dip. And there's, you know, really no way to get at that rather than guessing about it. Mike, do you have any guesses?
Yeah, I think my best guess is that people have gotten better at writing privacy policies to say we can do what we want with the data. Mm-hmm. And as you're following that privacy policy, there's nothing to sue about. That's number one. And then number two is there's really no remedy. So you can't prove there's specific harm, then filing the suit to get no remedy leads you to nothing at the end of the rainbow. You put those two things together, and it just doesn't make sense to file a privacy lawsuit.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And Joe points out in his article too that a lot of the, since there is no federal privacy law, which is what Irina and Sarah have been going back and forth about a bit, there are some privacy related statutes that are pretty old now, like the Electronic Communications Privacy Act, the Stored Communications Act, and the Video Privacy Protection Act, which we have a lot of fun discussing cases that come up under those statutes because they tend to be pretty far afield from what the legislators must have had in mind when they enacted them. Right. Sarah, any thoughts on this?
No, I think Mike's exactly right that companies are getting more sophisticated about how they handle privacy issues. And, you know, attorneys are probably getting tired of trying to rely on this outdated legislation or legislation that doesn't exactly fit or doesn't fit at all, like the Video Privacy Protection Act, to things that they're trying to regulate now. So, right. So yeah, I think you guys touched on it perfectly.
Okay. Any final thoughts on the privacy front before we move on, Irina?
I think we've captured it pretty well. As you pointed out from the beginning, there are costs and benefits to using all of these types of products, and you know, people need to be made aware of them both through the media and through these policies themselves, and know what they're getting themselves into. And as long as that happens, I think there is real hope that that market forces and competition will keep a lot of this stuff in check. And to the extent that there is abuse, it's something we're going to have to look into how we're fixing it.
Okay. Mike, any last thoughts?
Yeah, I guess when we talk about the creepiness factor, I think that, you know, you have to separate the data from the metadata, because I think you can think big on the creepiness factor. For example, mm-hmm. the government becoming a customer and saying, we'd like all the data on people who were in the same photograph with somebody who's an Iranian national. You could have all the photos removed. They don't have to share any of the photos, but that data is the exact type of data that you've given them consent mm-hmm. to give to advertisers. And if the government sets up a front of a company saying we want to advertise to Iranian nationals, then all of a sudden you've got spying going on, and that creeps me out.
Right. And of course, the government doesn't even have to set up a front, right? If it has...
Right, they just buy it.
Right. Or subpoena it. You know, I mean, sure. or we'll get into talking about the scope of the NSA's powers in the wake of what happened earlier this week in a little
right.
bit.
That was a bit
here
of
on
a
the
segue.
Show. Yes, exactly. But yes, they have many, many means of getting at that information. Let's put our first MCLE phrase into the show. We put these passphrases into the show twice during an episode so that if you are listening to the show for continuing legal or other professional education credit, you can demonstrate to an oversight body that you've actually watched or listened. You haven't just written down episode 306 of This Week in Law on a piece of paper or in a spreadsheet to fulfill your compliance obligations. So our first phrase is all your base. in honor of our discussion here around privacy. And let us move on to talk about some internet bad guys who've been getting their comeuppance in court lately, or not. All right, let's start out with Ross Ulbricht of the Silk Road, who has gotten a life sentence for his actions in, you know, he's been basically held up as really one of the worst kind of offenders, someone who did not deserve any sort of diminution in the severity of the sentence he was going to receive. Pretty much the justice system decided that he, you know, I mean, there's only one worse thing you can do other than a life sentence to someone. Also that there was no reason to back off on that firm sentence despite a frenzy of filings on that topic. Irina, this is another thing that you pay attention to is the criminal aspect of intellectual property and other internet-related violations. Were you surprised by the severity of Ross Ulbricht's sentence?
Not entirely surprised, just because of my generally pessimistic view of how we handle not even so much the sort of criminal IP side, although I've, you know, my own skepticism there, but more as far as how we handle the war on drugs, quote unquote, right? And I think that that's much more what this case was about. And, you know, you had like the victim impact statements by the families of people who died from the heroin that they bought from Silk Road. And I think it came a lot more down to the drug aspect of this. And, you know, certainly he had knowledge. I mean, certainly the site was not being run innocently by any means. But that being said, I mean, we are sending a drug dealer, let's say, or someone who facilitated drug dealing, rather, to prison for life. And am I comfortable with that? Absolutely not. And, but to me, that's an issue that's somewhat outside of the technology aspect of it, because that's not something that I'm comfortable with anyway.
Right. Sarah, how about you? Were you somewhat astounded, or did you think that that Ross was going down?
I thought he was probably going down, but I pretty much feel the same as Irina. I was not terribly surprised that it was that, you know, hit the maximum sentence, but it seems completely disproportionate to what he did. I mean, it's the same sentence we give murderers. And I guess he was accused of trying to murder people, but I don't think that he was actually, it definitely wasn't successful, and I don't think that any of that was actually proven in the case, but I could be wrong. But so yeah, it seems excessive, but I'm not terribly surprised.
Right. Mike, do you think that it should have factored into either the liability or the sentencing or both in this case, the fact that it was even possible to commit the acts that Ross Ulbricht did? And what I'm getting at there is, shouldn't he have been apprehended far earlier on, before he was able to establish this empire? Was this not in some ways a law enforcement fail as well?
Yes, it may well have been a law enforcement fail, but I can't imagine any judge saying, well, you know, they didn't catch you soon enough and you kept doing it, so we're going to give you a lighter sentence. That
excellent point.
Yeah. So you know, that may be an argument we can make as commentators, but I think it'd be hard for his lawyers to make with a straight face. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so I mean, basically, he could have done a lot of things, like this harm minimization argument, which is the one they did make, was also one that's like, that's a tough one to make with a straight face, but at least that one was a little bit closer to the mark.
Can you explain that for people who haven't read up on the back and forth of his sentencing as much as we have?
Well, my understanding is basically his argument was, look, I made a nice market where people don't get killed and shot doing, you know, doing drug trades on the street. And because of that, I should get a lighter sentence because I did this in such an orderly fashion. And the judge basically rejected that and said, well, you know, that just meant you could do a lot more of it and you're ignoring all the harm that happens when demand goes up because prices go up and then more people want to do it. And you've got lots of people who get killed making it and transporting it and all the other things. So I think at least that one was an argument, but, you know, you should have caught me earlier. Not so much.
Right. You should have caught me earlier. Could have been an argument. Another argument that could have been made, again, sort of echoing the world of IP, and I don't know if this argument was made, and I'm sure it wouldn't have made that big a difference, but it seems like something that is a parallel, at least to the civil side of things. And that is sort of a Sony versus Universal argument that, well, gee, there's a whole lot of legal activity that's possible in this marketplace as well. Irina, am I just drawing a comparison that shouldn't even exist?
You know, I don't think it's unfair to bring up that point. I mean, mm-hmm. I think that that is something that we should look at. And whenever we have a marketplace of any sort, I mean, take eBay, right? Lots of stuff gets sold on eBay that is, you know, infringing and et cetera. And the question there really becomes, infringing on trademarks, let's say, and the question there becomes, what is the entity doing about it? And in eBay's case, they can show we have this entire program in place. And so when companies like Tiffany try to sue them and say you're not doing enough, they're able to show this all these measures that they were taking. That wasn't really the case here, right? So Ulbricht knew he wasn't trying to stop it. He was making money off of all of these trades. Certainly, he's not a sympathetic character from that perspective at all. But I do think we have to always ask the question of in what ways is a technology beneficial as opposed to harmful? And whenever we're shutting down an operation, even like this one, it's going to sweep up a lot of good uses as well. So no, I don't think it would be crazy to bring that up.
Okay, good. I'm glad my chops as a criminal defense lawyer, which I've never been in my whole life, at least are somewhat still intact. Let's move on to our next internet bad guy, who's been much in the news lately, and that is Kim.com. I've sort of lost track of what's going on in all the extraditions and attempted extraditions and charges, etc. Irina, have you been following this more closely?
So my understanding is that at this time he is continuing to fight the extradition charges to the United States. But what happened is that in a civil procedure, the so-called doctrine of fugitive disentitlement was used against him, where the United States tried to seize assets that he held abroad in New Zealand by saying, you are not willing to come and stand trial for the criminal charges. Therefore, we will attempt to take away your civil assets through this procedure. And what happened most recently is that New Zealand said, we don't recognize this doctrine. And we're not going to apply it here. So basically telling the United States, we are not going to help you implement this doctrine that, you know, fundamentally goes against public policy. And I'm certainly no expert on New Zealand law, but from a common sense perspective, that makes a lot of intuitive sense to me. So .com is not done fighting the extradition procedure, and yet, and you know, this is part of a larger concern that I have about, you know, all kinds of civil forfeiture issues in the United States that some public interest law firms have been trying to fight. But this one is kind of a biggie because we're talking about a lot of assets and assets that are abroad that prematurely they were seizing his assets by saying, we're not going to let you develop your case as to whether you should be extradited or not. And we're preemptively going to make sure we get our hands on your assets. And New Zealand said, sorry, we're not playing that game. We're not going to be a part of that.
Sarah, that makes perfect sense to me. Do you see why were our tax dollars spent on such a flyer, do you think?
I should say that everything I know about civil forfeiture, I learned from a John Oliver episode. So that makes it very dangerous.
Yes.
But it seems like there are some, troubling public policy issues around civil forfeiture and how it's done. So it doesn't surprise me that another country would say this is against public policy. There isn't due process of law under their regime. So, but I don't know any of the particulars about it, but I guess that's kind of my gut reaction to the story.
Right. Mike, any thoughts?
Not too many. I don't have strong feelings about Kim.com. I do think civil forfeiture is ridiculous. Mm-hmm. So I can see why New Zealand would fight back, and I say more power to them.
I love that when people email me between the shows to ask for more information about things like civil forfeiture, net neutrality, I can, this just is another one that I can add to the list of, oh, you can watch this clip from John Oliver and learn everything you need to know. All right. Moving on to the folks behind Pirate Bay, Frederick Nish, if I'm saying his name correctly, was just released from prison. Again, Irina, since you've been the person studying and following more closely along with folks criminally prosecuted for IP-related crimes, have you been paying attention to the Pirate Bay folks?
I think that we need to be really, really careful in how we make use of criminal sanctions in the intellectual property world. This is something I've written about. I'm not somebody who believes that there is no place for them. I think there are some settings in which it makes sense to apply them. But here what is troubling is that we're talking about people who were running a website where, at least for the most part, other people were doing the infringing, right? So you have this question of secondary criminal liability. There have been attempts by prosecutors to import wholesale doctrines from the civil context into the criminal context here to get at the secondary liability. And it's not entirely clear to me what the argument is with the Pirate Bay people as to why we shouldn't just pursue them civilly. So a lot of them, we're not going to be able to get them anyway if these extraditions don't succeed. So we're spending a lot of resources potentially on this criminal stuff without it really coming to fruition. So to the extent that people say, oh, well, what if you hide your civil assets abroad? Well, in this case, it's like, well, what if the entire person is abroad? These criminal sanctions aren't going to do a whole lot of good if you can't get them back. And one of the arguments that makes sense in some contexts is, well, we should use criminal sanctions when we're not able to give enough disincentives to people to do it through civil means, where we're going after people that don't have deep pockets. They're not really going to feel it if we go after them with civil sanctions. But that's not the case here. So I don't really see the big benefit. And certainly there are some chilling effects that I'm concerned about in terms of people's willingness to run services in the future that, perhaps some illegal use will be made of them at some point. And all these things are on a spectrum. So I mentioned the eBay example, right? There you might have some trademark infringement, but there are many, many types of entities we can envision between eBay and something like Pirate Bay. And I think this is ultimately somewhat overblown.
Right. And I was curious too, all four of the founders or persons involved in creating Pirate Bay have now served prison sentences, all in Sweden, I believe, of various months. One had home arrest. I'm just wondering, Irina, if you think that, I'm not familiar with the specific Swedish laws that would have put them in jail, but would it happen here in the U.S.?
I believe that it would, and I believe that mm-hmm. in the United States, the sentences would be a heck of a lot longer than the sentences we see in Europe. Now, mm-hmm. I grew up in Europe. I think there are contexts in which the sentences in Europe are too low. There are, some countries where you go to prison for rape for 5 years. That's not acceptable. So I'm not somebody who says, you know, oh, all the time we need shorter prison sentences or anything like that. But in the United States, it really is rather troubling how high these potential sanctions are. And we saw some of this in the case of Aaron Schwartz, who, if people recall, committed suicide after he was threatened with very high sanctions. He was being threatened with approximately 50 years in prison. And then prosecutors came back and said, oh, don't worry, we would have never actually put him away. If you look at the sentencing guidelines, he was really only looking at 7, and we were offering him a plea for 6 months, and he didn't take it, and that's his own fault. But at the end of the day, when a prosecutor comes up to you, right, and says, here is the risk, right, here is the risk of 50 years or even 7 years of going away for data-related offenses, for IP-related offenses, that's, you know, not always. It's not always troubling, but there are a number of contexts in which it's troubling. And in the context of things like Pirate Bay, the fact that we're talking again about mainly secondary liability is disconcerting. But certainly they would have received no more favorable treatment in the U.S. and much more likely much harsher treatment.
Yes, he probably wouldn't have gotten his Nintendo in the U.S. either. Joe Mullen includes in his article writing up his release that Friedrich Nietzsche at one point during his imprisonment asked to have an original Nintendo in his cell, but Swedish authorities sadly denied the request. Mike, anything to add to this?
Yeah, I think Irina hits the key points. You've got two things going on here. You've got first, what do we do about copyright liability in a marketplace? And then second, what do we do about criminal liability for copyright infringement, especially where it's in the marketplace? So those are two very problematic issues. That said, if you are going to have a criminal sentence in a copyright marketplace, I can think of no better place to do it than Pirate Bay. It's clear what the folks intended there. They got notice and takedown. When the question is, would this happen in the U.S., I think the answer is probably not, because in the U.S. you get a notice provision and you take down the infringing link. There, they got the notice and they said, you know what, we don't have to take it down because we're not in the U.S., so we'll keep doing it. And apparently the Swedish government didn't like that. That kind of shows you the value of the safe harbors. To the copyright owner, not to the people who want to have the links, obviously. They thought they were safe, but the Swedish government thought they weren't. So
no, I've never thought about it in terms of the DMCA being a jail population reduction measure, but I think you're absolutely right that there is a process in place that probably leads to exactly what you just described, Mike. Sarah, anything to add?
Although presumably Pirate Bay wouldn't have, they could have taken down the stuff even though there was no DMCA in Sweden. They probably wouldn't have in the U.S. either. So I imagine they'd probably end up in jail here too. But I don't have anything else.
Yep. All right. Let's take a break and thank our sponsor for this episode of This Week in Law. This week, it's all about the money. And who's going to get you the money is FreshBooks. It's amazing how many lawyers I know spend way too much time practicing paperwork rather than practicing law. On top of their piles of affidavits and case files, there are billable hours that need tracking, expenses to manage, and client invoices to prepare and send. FreshBooks makes your life so much easier in that regard. I use FreshBooks in my law practice, and really the thing that I love about FreshBooks is, aside from talking about it on the show, is I don't have to talk about it or think about it or really do much to it at all. There are certain accounts where I do sort of routine, repetitive legal tasks every month, and I know I'm going to be billing a certain client for a certain amount. And if you have things that you can set up on autopilot like that, you do it once and it's done. Your invoice goes out, you get paid. It's a beautiful thing. The other thing is when you're much more involved in doing analysis or more detailed work, and you're having to pull in expenses that get included on the invoice, and you're having to give good, accurate, detailed descriptions of your time, and you're having to track a lot of time when you're in a profession like the law, that's how you get paid, is by describing your services. FreshBooks just makes that equally seamless and easy and wonderful. You can do it from your desktop computer. You can do it from your phone. Everything is centralized and syncs up. The invoices you create are very professional and slick looking, and you're creating them in just minutes. It's so much nicer than trying to use other kinds of accounting software to accomplish this, or, you know, just a plain spreadsheet doesn't wind up making a great impression on your clients either. It's very easy to track your time. The fact that there's a mobile app for this recognizes that we're all on the road all the time, and that work just doesn't happen only in your office. It happens all kinds of places. Sometimes it happens when you're on vacation, and still you need to capture what's going on so that it can be included and you can get back to your vacation. So it really makes the whole work-life balance thing a much nicer process too. If you have any questions as you're using the product, the award-winning FreshBooks support rock stars are waiting. There's a real live person on the other end of the phone to help, and they're extraordinarily helpful. You can get started with it very simply. It's totally free for 30 days with no obligation. Go to freshbooks.com/TWiL, and don't forget to enter TWiL, T-W-I-L, in the How Did You Hear About Us section. You can start your 30-day free trial today. Thank you so much, freshbooks.com, for your support of This Week in Law. All right, I think we will move on to revisit a story that we talked about last week, which is the fact that the Supreme Court might take the Oracle versus Google case on certiorari. Oh, goodness, no, let's not get into the discussion about how we pronounce certiorari one more time. But we want to consider the impact now of this case on various other languages, not just those that might be included in an API. And of course, that all relates to copyright. So the Supreme Court is considering whether to look at the Oracle versus Google case, which has made a determination against Google on the copyrightability of Oracle's Java APIs. And the reason that I bring this up again, even though we touched on it last week and the Solicitor General's brief that's been filed, is because I hadn't really considered the point raised by Charles Dwan at Slate. He's got a great article there about the copyrightability of language in general. And he, of course, pulls out Klingon as an example of a language that could run into copyright issues if this case is allowed to stand. Mike, I know you're interested in this case. Had you considered the impact of the current legal landscape on Klingonese?
No, not on Klingonese, that's for sure. I think the comparison to other languages is interesting. I'm not sure I buy into it completely. I agree that you should be able to use APIs, and I agree that you can't really copyright a language. I just don't know that the analogy is one-to-one. When I think of what Google did here, it's more that they recreated the dictionary. So they grouped all of the words with their definitions into certain packages. And that is part of the creativity that is different from just using the words, that is the commands themselves. So for example, the analogy to Klingonese would be you're free to use Klingon, but you can't make a photocopy of the Klingonese dictionary that somebody wrote. Now, like I said, I think what Google did here is okay for a variety of reasons. I just am not sure that it means that if it were – I'm not sure that the Federal Circuit's ruling as it stands means that nobody can use Klingonese anymore.
Right. Do you think that there's enough of a question about that or the other aspects of this case that the Supreme Court will actually take it up and take a look?
I think so, and I sure hope so. I mean, APIs are critical to how everybody does programming, and the ability to write compatible programs is critical to competition. So I think this is a question that that the Supreme Court has to take up. I think this should not be an issue that you leave to fair use analysis.
Of course, the number one comment on this really excellent article by Charles Dwan at Slate. I highly recommend it. You can check it out. All the points that we've been discussing today are at delicious.com/thisweekinlaw/306. And its top comment here is, does anyone else get very nervous when super technical cases make their way to the Supreme Court? I suspect the majority of its members still have VCRs with clocks set to perpetually blinking 12 o'clocks. So there is that always that bit of trepidation. But the Supreme Court's actually been doing kind of well on the very technical cases that it has gotten in recent terms. So I do have high hopes that they'd be able to make their way through this thicket, particularly if the lawyers briefing the case can write anywhere near as well as this Charles Dwan piece, which in a few paragraphs very succinctly describes and makes comprehensible this very complicated case, as well as trying to grapple with the complicated notions of languages within languages. And he calls it this inception-like language within a language common, and describes how it's pretty problem, and describes how it's pretty common. So I do have high hopes that the court could grapple with this intelligently, and some faith that it could do so. Now it just has to take the case. Sarah, you weren't with us last week. Do you have any thoughts on Oracle versus Google going before the Supreme Court?
I mean, I agree that I hope that it happens. I think they probably will take the case. I also thought that Slate piece was really clear. And yeah, if people could write like that and explain things, I'm also confident the Supreme Court justices, they're smart people. They can understand. I'm really intrigued by this dictionary analogy Mike raised, because I think, I guess, to me, it raises the question of, so if a dictionary was copyrighted, I would think that the only way you'd be able to implicate that copyright is if you copied the dictionary in its entirety without changing the order at all of the words. And I don't know for sure, but I'm guessing that that's not what happened with the API commands, that Google probably didn't just plug it in exactly as, you know, in the exact order that it was, but maybe that's wrong. Michael, do you happen to know? Is it the case that they didn't have to use them in any different sequence?
Well, they. So the answer to that is, well, first of all, the Klingonese dictionary, one of the IRC commenters noted that somebody actually, Mark Okren, wrote the Klingonese dictionary. This is where everybody gets Klingonese. So if you copied it, it is copyrighted. Mm-hmm. To answer the question, they did have to put the exact, they're called header files essentially, but it's basically a definition of what each function will look like with the same terms, with the same name and same variable names, and they had to divide them up into what are called packages, which are basically just file groups in the same way. Now, they might not be the exact same order within the package, because that doesn't matter, but they are divided up, you know, file input output is in one package, you know, math processing is another package. And in fact, Oracle said that the way they divided into packages was part of their creative decision making. And what Google says is they had to do the exact way, because otherwise the API doesn't work. If it doesn't match, people can't use the Java language commands with the API. And so this is why I think you should be able to do what they did. But why I also think it's not exactly the same as a dictionary, because there may have been comments in the Oracle version that didn't get copied over into the Google version, for example.
Right. Yeah, it feels like it's so tied to the functionality that it shouldn't be copyrightable.
Right.
And in terms of the Klingonese dictionary, that feels to me like the Harry Potter lexicon in some ways. And because it's fictional, it seems it has, you know, an extra element of expression, I think, than something that's rooted in function or fact, like the API, or I'm trying to think of another example, like maybe a mathematical theorem, for example, something that there's no other way to express it other than, you know, this one way that means what it means. It feels a little bit different than something like Klingonese, which is made up out of nothing.
I have a couple of points to add to the discussion. Number one is that the excellent piece we keep referring to, the author Charles Dwan, is the director of the Patent Reform Project at Public Knowledge. So if we're hoping for the Supreme Court to get some briefing along the lines of this article, I think there's a good chance that could happen in the form of an amicus brief. And finally, certain folks in IRC have been going off at us, teeing off on us for using the term Klingonese as opposed to Klingon. And I would assert that both are acceptable. Klingonese is less common, but I will cite you to the Trouble with Tribbles episode of Star Trek, the famous bar scene, the Klingon commander Korax, who's taunting Mr. Scott and trying to start the fight. And at one point, he actually, and I pulled this up, I'm so happy I was able to find it, when he gets around to insulting the Enterprise, and that's how he gets Scotty into the fight, and he says, "Of course I'd say that Captain Kirk deserves his ship. We like the Enterprise. We really do. That saggy old rust bucket is designed like a garbage scow. Half the quadrant knows it. That's why they're learning to speak Klingonese." So there's my citation for you. You know, we lawyers love our citations. Now that I've gone down that rat hole, let's put garbage scow as our second MCLE passphrase for this episode of This Week in Law. And let's move on to some far loftier topics in the realm of legislation and policy. All right, so much to talk about here. I scarcely know where to start. Let's start with the NSA, shall we? Since there's been, last weekend was quite exciting on Sunday and Monday, and I think it was Tuesday when the USA Freedom Act actually passed. We had a couple of days of Section 215 expiring, as we mentioned last week that it would, unless it was renewed. It was not renewed, but the USA Freedom Pact Act did in fact pass. So I'm going to defer to our esteemed academics to try and unpack this all for us. Let's start with you, Irina. Has anything really changed?
A little bit. I mean, first of all, we have to look at the symbolic nature of this, certainly. And this was a big deal. It tends to be very difficult to roll back these kinds of measures. It tends to be very difficult to roll back government powers. And so one thing that this truly showed is the importance of sunset provisions. That's something that, you know, I've thought about. Roberto Romano at Yale Law School has written about this as well. And without that, it would have been extremely difficult to do even the little bit that people have been able to do here. What's going to change now is that the government is going to have to overcome greater hurdles to get at the mass collected data that previously they were able to just grab. So records about phone calls of people, they're going to have to use warrants in order to access those. And that is a big deal. We're also seeing this on smaller scales. You know, we're seeing some state legislation being passed to get at some of these things, you know, CalECPA, et cetera. And so that is significant. And that might be the beginning. It might be a sign of things to come. You know, hopefully we will see greater protections in this area than we have seen so far. And at the very least, I think there was a sense of a victory also by the grassroots movement on this level. So that there were really a number of people that joined together, nonprofits, academics, the media, and shook things up and were able to say, no, we're going to put a stop to this. In the beginning, we didn't even know this was going on. As we all know, the Patriot Act was passed quickly, hastily, without being read, which I think was disastrous. And I think we've seen the consequences of that. And, you know, some people think it's a little bit unfortunate how this all came out, that it came out through the controversial figure of Edward Snowden. But be that as it may, we were able to find out about it. And so at least some of this was rolled back. And it's also been very interesting to see how this is becoming a cross-ideological issue, where it's no longer the case that you have, you know, one of the two major political parties standing for freedom and the other one not standing for freedom. And there are going to be some interesting bridges that I think will be built in Washington as a result. And I personally am excited about that.
All right, Mike, what's your take?
I guess I'm this episode's resident skeptic, because I'm not convinced that much is going to change. The primary rollbacks were, now there won't be bulk metadata on phones being held by the NSA. Instead, the phone companies will hold it. And they have a little bit higher duty than, for example, all the other folks who were collecting all our private data. But to the extent that people use services where they grant consent, the phone companies can share it with who they want, et cetera. But let's say they don't and they hold it, then now if the NSA is interested in a phone number, they ask the phone companies get the data. And so basically the search is now moved from inside the NSA to inside the phone company. Will this make a huge difference? I don't think so. Will it make some difference? Probably. It's not all being held by the government anymore. So that's a good thing. The other thing that's been rolled back is a little bit of the secrecy of the FISA courts, the security courts. They will have to publish some of their decisions, and before they didn't publish any. Now, I think time will tell how much they actually publish. Will it just be the big ones where they make the big rules, like you can do all of this data collection? That was a big one. Or mm-hmm. will it be the nitty gritty? So, you know, maybe. I my own view is very little is going to change. And even if it does, we're not going to know about it anyway.
Yeah, it kind of does feel like the transparency portions of USA Freedom were put in there to make people like us feel better about things, as opposed to maybe making, you know, I don't know if the first rule of FISA Club isn't still going to be you don't talk about FISA Club. What do you think, Sarah?
I think you guys are depressing me. I was kind of excited about this. No, I don't know. I thought that EFF's press release about it made a good point, which is that, you know, this is the public actually recognizing privacy harms and getting something, not only, you know, just killing bills, but actually, you know, pushing actual legislation. And of course, it's not perfect legislation, and they acknowledge that. I don't even think EFF formally supported it at the end of the day. But but it is progress. So yeah, from a symbolic perspective, I think it's definitely a good thing. And I do think that, no, you know, some checks are better than no checks. Although, you know, Michael, you're probably right that, that it's not going to fix everything for sure. As a practical matter, but it's definitely a step in the right direction. I was excited about it until this conversation.
So they talk about security theater. Maybe this is transparency theater, just for our benefit. I don't know. Only time will tell. Speaking of security theater, there was this is sort of an aside. We went from the NSA to the TSA in one fell swoop here, but the TSA news that broke this week was sort of entertaining, and I don't know why I think it's fun and funny. It's really not that funny that our security measures are working so poorly, but Irina, you want to chime in on this one?
Sure. So what happened this week, and you know, this isn't the first time that we're seeing this kind of thing, is that there have been a number of covert tests of how well the TSA screening system is really working. And it turns out that it's really not working very well at all. And something like 95% of, you know, pseudo explosives that the covert agents tried to smuggle through, they were able to smuggle through. Now, I think there is a real moment here for soul searching where we have to make a decision as to what we want to do. What is going to happen is there's going to be a push for, oh, that means we need harsher security. We need more security. And that's going to make us more secure overall. And we all know that we've heard that story before. We have heard that story before many times. This isn't the first time that we're seeing these kinds of covert tests reveal that this is all just theater. Travelers are being massively inconvenienced. There are great economic costs, both from the slowdowns that this is causing and from the price of bringing in these instruments. If one follows the money trail of how we got some of these, the backscatters, et cetera, in the first place, it had a lot more to do with political forces, I think, than really with security. So I'm a significant skeptic in this area. I think it's time to say that the rhetoric of we're going to be safer if only we're willing to give up a little bit more freedom has completely not panned out, that we need to recognize that we will never be completely safe, that some things are always going to slip through, and that the measures that we're putting in place are not worth it, that the harassment and breach of civil liberties that is happening at our nation's airports every single day to millions of people is unacceptable, and frankly, that we would be better off going back to something that was closer to what we had before with less micromanagement. You know, there have been also calls for greater privatization of TSA, maybe having more experimentation of different kinds of models. But we know that what's happening now is not working, and I don't see any reason that we should trust that more will be better.
All right, let's move on to some of the other things on the policy front that have been in the news this week. So much. Irina, you mentioned this. I hadn't seen this. But topical in that yesterday was the anniversary. I'm not sure which anniversary, the 10th anniversary of Tiananmen Square. 6/4/1989. So quite a while ago. And it's not an actual, yes, it was 1989. So we're not, you know, we're rolling up to one of those big anniversaries. But it was an anniversary nonetheless. There was an interesting recognition of that anniversary on the part of China's government. Can you tell us about that?
Yes. So this isn't the first anniversary that this sort of thing is happening, but every year around the time of this anniversary, there's a greater interest on the part of the Chinese people to do searches, to look up things, to commemorate. And so the government puts in place a number of crackdowns to prevent that. So what we saw last year when it was a big anniversary, the 25th anniversary, is that they basically prevented a number of search terms from working, or something like 64 search terms. And this year, you know, people are getting more and more clever to try to get around these measures. And so the government is cracking down on certain payment amounts not being allowed, right? Amounts that, whose figures would be reminiscent of the anniversary. A lot of what is happening in China on that front remains very, very troubling. So if you look at the early days of the internet, there was this great sense of freedom. And there was this great hope that this would bring liberties even to countries that didn't have certain forms of freedom of the press, etc. But the Chinese government and others like it have been quite efficient with projects like the Golden Shield Project, where through a combination of technological means and putting in place armies of people whose entire job it is to sit there and monitor chat rooms and monitor forums and take out things that are not flattering to the government and impersonate average citizens to pretend to be on the side of the government and defend things, that they've really managed to have a massive crackdown. And some people are able to pull out of this. But, you know, I think especially when we live in an era where Much of our economy is starting to depend on China, where, you know, at some schools, including here in New York, Chinese has become the mandatory second language, the first one that children learn in school after English, that we need to think about some of the repercussions of what we're doing, that we need to think about what it means for big companies to be doing business in China and to be facilitating some of these things. That's part of why Google pulled out about 5 years ago, but Yahoo remained. And we have to think through what, you know, what this means. But what is sort of hopeful is that, like I was saying, people are getting more and more clever about getting around these things. And so, you know, certainly some of these payment amounts were not coincidences and people did it on purpose. And I think the spirit of freedom is alive in China and that there are people who are seeking new means of expression. And hopefully with new technologies, and some speculate even with the things that Google learned back before it pulled out, we might be able to circumvent some of the, you know, the great firewall of China and get people more access to information and maybe arrive at more political and cultural change.
Yeah, it's a fascinating story. The message that people were getting if they tried to transfer amounts like they would get an error that read, "Unusual transaction, please try again." So it is fascinating to see the Chinese people trying to make a statement that would get by government censorship and the government actually recognizing that a political statement or a speech movement could originate in small transfers of money. Sarah, any thoughts on this?
Just that it's interesting to me that it ties a little bit to the TSA security theater story, because we're talking about how the TSA is always one step behind. And similarly, they're always, you know, people are going to always be finding other ways to assert their speech and their independence. So it's kind of interesting tie there. But
right, Mike, where do you stand on China and companies doing business there?
Well, I think it's hard to not do business there. There are a lot of people who live there, and there's lots of business to be done. But every time we move forward and it seems like it's a normal place to do business, something like this happens and you're reminded, oh, you know, to quote Forrest Gump, it's like this whole other country. And they do some things differently. And it's tough. It's tough. It's tough to, you know, respect cultural norms that are so different from our own, while also doing business. So, you know, I have mixed feelings about it.
All right. Well, something I have mixed feelings about for other reasons would be the state of Nevada is attempting to enact legislation that would allow a new form of gambling, a more video game oriented gambling. Legislation signed earlier this month by the Nevada Governor Brian Sandoval would have a skills based element to a new kind of, I don't know if we're going to call them slot machines or what, you know, how they would play out, but it's really like more sort of going in and playing a video game for money. And if you win, you would win actual money. This is an interesting development, sort of, you know, forward looking, innovative, trying to get to the modern day gamer. Mike, would you pay a fee to play a shoot 'em up game in Vegas if you could, you know, if you were really good and could win $100?
Well, if I was really good and could win $100, maybe, but I'm not really good. So, you know, I do this now. It's called Chuck E. Cheese with my kids. only I pay to get tickets that are overpriced for like really bad tchotchkes. You know, I guess whatever sells. I mean, I guess they want in on, they're probably losing some business to like stupid video games on cell phones and tablets. So they got to do something. So I guess this is it.
Right. Maybe they're losing business to their own, you know, arcade adjacent to the actual gambling floor. Sure. Why not bring those folks in? What were you going to say, Sarah?
Oh, I was just going to ask, I don't actually know why does it require new legislation? Is it the case that right now it's illegal to have a skills-based, it can't be illegal to do skills-based gambling because isn't blackjack and some of those games, presumably some skills involved, right? So I was just kind of curious about
I think it's the machines themselves that are regulated pretty tightly and what they can do and how they can work. So, you know, I don't know all the particulars, but it doesn't surprise me that they would have to have new legislation to have a new kind of gambling machine that would be legal.
Gotcha.
Irina, any thoughts on this?
Yeah, as Sarah was just hinting at, we already have skills-based gambling. I mean, you're looking at blackjack or poker. I don't really see a fundamental difference here. The argument that you tend to hear in this context is that, well, every new type of game of this sort has the potential for addiction and maybe has the potential for to create addiction in a different kind of population. And I think this comes down to some of your general views on gambling and personal freedom. I certainly don't have a problem with it. I think people should be able to play these games and spend their money on it. And some people will make good money on it. I think a lot of us knew people in law school who made money playing professional poker. And this could be another means of this sort. And for most people, it's just going to be some form of entertainment that they engage in every once in a while. So, you know, generally speaking, I mean, outside of the context of again, fraud and things like that, I'm skeptical of the regulations being as tight as they are, and for it to be necessary at all to have that we have a framework where you need a new law to allow video games where you can make money in Vegas.
Yeah, I hadn't really thought about it in terms of addiction until you brought that up. And it is a little scary that you could take two things that could lead to unhealthy addictions all on their own and marry them together into a profit-making enterprise. Did you guys see the story? Oh, goodness gracious, this is an old story, but I just got sent it this morning. So this actually happened back in 2012, but it's still a terrible story there was a gamer in a Taipei internet cafe who actually died at his station. He was 23 years old, but nonetheless had a heart problem and had basically forgotten to eat, drink, or move around because he'd been so engaged in his game and his heart seized up and he died. And he was there for 9 hours before his fellow gamers realized that he'd actually expired at the video game machine. So with that level of, it's easy to throw around the word addiction, but that level of intensity around your video game playing coupled with a financial gambling incentive could be pretty scary. And I wonder if that has come up at all, you know, and it's, if anything, the state of Nevada is probably not too concerned with those kinds of considerations, but who knows, maybe it's part of the debate about that legislation. Any further thoughts on the addiction point, Mike?
Well, I was thinking when she said that it's not just addiction. When you mentioned that it's skill, and I was thinking back to the Chuck E. Cheese experience, mm-hmm. You keep playing it over and over and over, not just because you're addicted, but because you think you can get better at it. Mm-hmm. With a slot machine, you know 98% of the time you're going to lose. And so that next quarter or dollar, whatever your nickel or whatever you're playing, you know there's a shot you could win, but there's a good shot you're going to lose. But if it's skill-based, you know with that quarter, even if you lose, you're going to get better. And so you're going to spend money on the losing and keep spending money. And that is a problem, even if you're not addicted, that perhaps they need to think about as policymakers. I tend to come out the same way, which is, you know, it is what it is. Gambling is gambling, but I think the incentive to keep playing is much more so there because of these are skill-based video games and you're paying for it.
If I can jump in here,
sure.
I don't know if I fully agree with that. You know, I'd have to go back and review the psychology literature, but I think what tends to happen with the people who are really hooked to the slot machines, that tends to work according to the principle of intermittent reinforcement. And I think some people actually, of the ones who become the hardcore addicts, I think some of them actually do trick themselves into believing that there is a skills portion when in fact there isn't. And you know of people who, like, they walk in and it's like, this is the lucky machine, right? This is the one I need to go to. Or they feel like, oh, I've had, you know, a certain kind of streak, and so this is what's going to happen next. And so they actually have this false sense of being able to control the process. Whereas here, you can actually control the process, and that seems a lot fairer. And that's why you don't hear of as many people making a living from slot machines as you hear of people making a living from poker. And it's become, I would say, basically a respectable profession. And the same way, I think we're going to see people making money off of the video gaming. There was already some of that, but I think we're going to see people actually moving to Nevada to make money off of these video games. And why not, right? I mean, there are worse jobs one could have.
Yeah, that'll be really fascinating to see play out. All right, I think we're going to move on to our tip and resource of the week. Our tip, Mike, this might be near and dear to your heart. The first person and lawyer representing this person to file a lawsuit against the EFF for defamation. This involves a lawyer in Atlanta named Scott Horstemeyer. And his lawyer, whose name I will find shortly, Asmer, I think is his last name. There it is, Asmin. I hope I'm pronouncing that properly. They have decided that being featured, Mr. Horstemeyer had a patent of his featured as the stupid patent of the month. At the EFF site. He didn't take kindly to that. He didn't take kindly to the way it was written up, and actually is bringing a defamation claim against the EFF against this. And the reason I brought it up as a tip is I think that that's just a really bad idea. You don't want to be suing the EFF for defamation, no matter how put out you are as having been featured as the stupid patent of the month. Mike, do you agree?
Yeah, I agree. I mean, there's a lot of this patent holders. This is not the first patent holder suit not liking how they've been called out by other people. The old patent troll tracker blog got sued by folks who didn't like being called patent trolls. It's just not a good idea. And the EFF, they relish First Amendment litigation, so they are not the people you want to be suing.
No. Not at all. So don't be suing the EFF for defamation unless you really, really, really have a strong case. And I'm just not seeing that here. Our resource of the week harkens back to our discussion about Google earlier. And I've actually had this in my notes to put in as a resource for a long while. So it jibes really well with our discussion today. And that is the Digital Advertising Alliance Consumer Choice page. And this is the place you can go. It's at aboutads.info/choices. And you can go here to find out companies who are customizing ads for your browser and opt out of them doing so. Now, this is not every single advertiser out there, but it's a good chunk of them. So if you get creeped out about customized ads in your browser and you would rather not have targeted ads sent at you, this is one way to combat that. So Digital Advertising Alliance Consumer Choice page. They will spend a lot of time reminding you that being able to target ads to you is how a lot of products are able to be free. But nevertheless, they make this tool available. So check that out if you are so inclined. And I am so excited that we've been able to have this conversation today. It's been really, really fascinating. I've really enjoyed meeting you, Irina. Tell us what's going on at Hofstra that people might be interested in checking out, if there's anything at all or going on with you.
Well, a few months ago, we just opened our Center for Intellectual Property Law, which I am directing. So that's definitely one of the big things that's going on right now. We have a lot of great offerings in IP and some super excited students running our Hofstra IP Law Association. So IP is really booming at the school right now. So we're all very excited about that, and I'm glad to be a part of that.
Well, you know, I'm biased, but I think it's one of the most fascinating parts of the law you can study. So I'm glad to hear that folks are flocking to you and that it is booming there at Hofstra. Michael, how about you out at Villanova? Things booming there too?
Things are booming. We've started a new IP and entrepreneurship and business center and an entrepreneurship clinic. School's out. But we're actually hosting a Senate Budget Committee on June 8th, so we're busy even into the summer.
That's great. Anything else you want to highlight for us as far as the things you'll be speaking at, speakers who are coming to your school?
Let's see here. I'm speaking in Chicago this summer in August, and we've got a variety of speakers coming next fall, although I don't have them in mind at the moment. So, boy, I wasn't expecting that question. I've drawn a time. I've usually got my whole calendar in front of me, but I've drawn a blank here.
I'm usually speaking somewhere. There's a long summer between now and then, and I bet if people follow you at Prof. Risch on Twitter, they can find out more about it as we're closer to those dates, right?
That's exactly right. I always announce where I'm going to be speaking.
That's great. Hey, Sarah, it's great to see you again this week.
Thanks. Yeah, I'm glad to be back. It was fun.
Good stuff going on with Creative Commons these days, I'm sure.
Yeah. One thing I was going to mention is I just this week published, I turned a presentation that I did recently into a really long, well, I think it said it was a 12-minute read on Medium about why content sharing is good for business. So if anyone's interested, I would urge you to check that out.
Oh, good. Kind of why is content sharing good for business? Give us the thumbnail.
The thumbnail sketch is most people use it as a publicity machine. So having your content move around the web rather than stuck on a specific platform. And then I get into kind of the more advanced, I guess I'd call it, ways of using CC, which is about building community and the social good element and things like that. But it's intended to just kind of be a primer for those who don't know anything about Creative Commons and how it might fit in with what they do. So,
right. And you've been writing great stuff at Medium lately. People should definitely check out your page there. It's the same as your Twitter handle, right? S. Hinch Pearson?
Yep, that's right.
Yep. All right, good. So for those in need of a long read on the beach as we get into our summertime season here, definitely bookmark Sarah because she's been writing some great stuff.
Thank you.
So we're so glad that you've been able to join us for our very interesting discussion today. If you've done so at 11 o'clock Pacific time, 1800 UTC, congratulations, you've watched us record the show live. That's when we do record the show each Friday. If you can't join us live, don't worry about it because the show is on demand for your pleasure at twit.tv/twill in various formats, however you like to enjoy. My son always asks me, Mom, are you on TV? And I tell him, well, you know, in various ways, yes, I am. So the ways that you can get our nice high def video up on your TV screen include Roku and YouTube, various other ways listed there on our show page. So however you like to enjoy. And, you know, it works great. Audio only too, or on a tablet or a phone. I love that our shows are all distributed in ways that are easy for people to enjoy wherever they are, whenever they have time. So we hope that you will take advantage of that. We also hope that you'll get in touch with us between the shows. You can email Sarah. She is sarahp@twit.tv. I'm denise@twit.tv if you want to get in touch with us that way. You can find us on Twitter or Facebook or Google+, all great ways to give us comments on the show, guest suggestions, your take on whether one should say Klingon or Klingonese. We'd love to hear with you from you with whatever is on your mind. And I'd just like to say one more sincere thank you to our panel for today. I've really enjoyed our discussion. I'm so grateful for you to take the time and join us today and read through this massive list of stories that I always send people every week to prepare to the show. You guys have been really prepared and really on the ball, and you've really helped us understand a couple of big, important problems that have been much in the news this last week. So I'm really, really grateful to you for joining us, and to all of you in the audience who've joined us as well. Thank you so much, and we'll see you on the next This Week in Law.